It is a season of choosing, ladies and gentlemen, that we are entering into. But the choice will not only be about competing visions. The campaign is going to focus on records and plans and ideas. It should, it will. And to their credit, our opponents have released their plan. Their detailed results of their policy review, I happen to have a copy of it. Here it is. It was just released. And something strange happened when it was released. We went through a process like this similarly, remember, back in 2004. This wasn't released by the leader of the party. It was nowhere to be seen. In fact, I don't think there was a press conference. I think they just issued a press release and had one of the MLAs take calls, and I thought that was strange until I read some of the stuff in here. And now I think Mr. Lingenfelter showed excellent judgment in not wanting to necessarily have to answer questions about what's in this particular policy document. There are some good ideas. We're going to look at them. Some of them notionally and directionally are similar to things that we've been doing or things that we're looking at as well, but there's a lot of crazy in here, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, someone said last week that this is, he called it a piñata of crazy. Hit it with a stick and more crazy comes out. For example, they're going to have essential services legislation without essential services legislation. I guess maybe Harry Potter will be the advisor on that and make that happen. I don't know. For example, our opponents, if they win the next election, they're going to use hundreds of millions of taxpayers' dollars, likely, possibly, to risk in taxpayers' money now, not anyone else's, to risk in setting up a new crown corporation called Sask Drugs. Sask Drugs will manufacture and sell prescription medicine. Hands up, who's prepared to buy prescriptions from the people that brought you Spudco? I think maybe there was some focus testing of the proposed product for this Crown Corporation that was being sampled when they came up with the with the idea. I'm not sure what they were thinking. Maybe they thought, look, the province is sick of the NDP, so let's give them a prescription. If that's true, if that's the case, we in the Saskatchewan Party would say, don't take a prescription for that, practice abstinence. And then they're proposing rent control, that the industry, real estate developers, mayors, and others who are in jurisdictions that have tried it have said will actually reduce the supply of rental accommodations. And a royalty tax hike, even though we currently have the highest potash taxes in the world, ladies and gentlemen, a royalty tax hike that will risk thousands of construction jobs on expanding potash mine sites and more permanent mining jobs when those expansions are done. There seems to be a pattern forming for our opponent. I'm not sure he or they understand basic economics. His resource policy would lead to fewer resource jobs. His housing policy would lead to less housing. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Lingonomics. We should probably coin that word. Use it again. This is a season of choosing. And more every day, the alternatives are becoming clear. We will continue to offer our plan. It will always be a costed plan, as it was in the last election. You're going to have it to campaign on when you're door knocking for your respective candidates. And you will have something more. There is something very different going to happen in this election later this year. In the last number of elections, the incumbent seemed to have run away from their record. Do you remember that? They wanted to run on fear campaigns and the wolf in sheep's clothing and all of that. Ladies and gentlemen, in this election, for the first time in a very long time, a government will run proudly on its record. It is a record of keeping our promises, now over 100, and with this budget, the final implementation of revenue sharing and property tax relief will have completed the platform we campaigned on 3.5 years ago. It is a record of setting targets and then achieving those targets. We said we would implement the most aggressive youth retention program in the nation, And we did, and it's working. We said we would attract and train and employ 800 new nurses in the province. Our opponents said it couldn't happen. We did it ahead of schedule, and it's working. We said we would build a real partnership with First Nations, and today we're working on some exciting projects around reducing the gap in educational outcomes between Aboriginals and non-Aboriginals, and we have forged an economic partnership with First Nations in this province. We promised to reduce wait times for surgery to 3 months within a four-year time frame. We're making progress on that. Wait times are being reduced. We said we would eliminate the wait list for those with intellectual disabilities that need a place to live and the dignity of home, and we're ahead of schedule on that commitment. We said we would deliver that elusive but stable municipal revenue sharing program that municipalities have wanted for 16 years, and we'll get the job done in just a few weeks. We promised we'd finally provide sustainable and long-lasting education property tax relief, and we'll get that job done in this budget as well, to the point where a lot of farmers are going to be saving 80% in terms of the education tax they paid under the other guys versus what they'll be paying after this next budget. We promised 120 additional police officers in our first term to make our streets safer, and we have delivered on that promise. We promised to increase the number of training seats from 60 to 100 at the College of Medicine and 60 to 120 residency positions in the province. We will achieve that objective before the election. We promised that our government would stop neglecting and ignoring and disrespecting rural Saskatchewan. And we have kept that promise, ladies and gentlemen. Crop insurance improvements and education tax relief and being there for producers when they have needed us and working with a cooperative federal government to help deliver help when it was needed. And may I say this, as long as the Saskatchewan Party has the unqualified privilege to be the government of Saskatchewan, rural Saskatchewan can expect to be treated with respect, can expect to be recognized as an engine of growth and, in many ways, the heart of this great province. We make that commitment every single year, and I make it again today at this annual convention. We promise good fiscal management. Ladies and gentlemen, the debt is down. We're going to pay a little more off in a few weeks. It's down by 40%. The infrastructure deficit we've inherited is being reduced. Taxes are lower today. We've made investments in people. And we've done all of this with a balanced budget and money in the bank. We've kept the promise for fiscal responsibility, too. Ladies and gentlemen, the best indicator of future conduct is past conduct. So when you're campaigning for us, for your candidates, when you're on the doorstep and you have that new plan that we'll be presenting, and the person at the door says, how will I know, how can I believe that you will keep these promises, bring the other platform from 2007 with you? Because we have a record of keeping promises. That's how we do things in the Saskatchewan Party. And there is more. We will have some new ideas of our own to talk about on the doorsteps of this province, and we will have our unchanging and unshakable vision for growth in this province. Our growth agenda has never changed. From the day of its creating till the present, its components have remained the same. They are lower taxes. We're going to make some more progress there. They are less debt, fiscal responsibility, infrastructure renewal, both for the new economy and the traditional economy. They include regulatory competitiveness. Yes, we need balanced labor legislation in the province of Saskatchewan that's competitive with other jurisdictions and fair to both sides. We have it now, and we're not going back. National and international engagement is part of our growth agenda. The New West Partnership, the largest free trade zone now in North America, the three half provinces of Alberta and British Columbia and Saskatchewan, together again, and we're engaging outside of the borders of our country with trade missions. We'll be in India next week. India currently, of all of its imports from Canada, 44% of them come from our province. We should be working on that market. We'll lead a trade mission of 80 companies to India just in the next few days to build that relationship. an innovation agenda has been part of our growth agenda. We're saying that it's important to use the wealth of resource economy to invest in today, to lower taxes, to build some schools and some hospitals and pay down some debt, but we need to think about tomorrow because these are non-renewable resources. And so our vision is that we would also use the wealth of today and invest in tomorrow. And you've seen some pretty exciting announcements at the University of Saskatchewan this week, haven't you? With a brand new nuclear science center of excellence and a PET scan and a cyclotron and a linear accelerator, and we will lead the world in the development of small modular reactors, small reactor technology. CCS and clean coal is part of our innovation agenda, as are life sciences. We have a solid growth agenda, and we will offer it again to the people in just a few months. And as we get closer to that election, let us be more determined than ever to remember that this growth agenda is never the end. It has always been, it must always be, the means to an end. In my first speech as a leadership candidate back in 2004, I talked about the real reasons for the case our party must make. I said you wouldn't find them in statistics or flow charts or reports from the conference board. You'd find them in the pictures on your refrigerator door and the pictures on refrigerator doors across this province. We pursue growth not for the conference board, not for the chartered bank economists. We pursue it for Miranda Beletsky, a recent paralyzed young lady studying at SIAST who has a dream of being a gold medalist in wheelchair basketball. And now, because of growth, we can provide her some support, some funding like other provinces do for athletes, for Miranda. That's why we pursue growth. We pursue our growth agenda for a 28-year-old mom named Candace. She's living in Regina and she has a little girl and big dreams. Because of growth, we can offer programming and training that she can take a course at SIAST and now be fully employed and likely not paying any income tax provincially, because our government has dropped 92,000 low-income people from the income tax rolls. That's why we pursue growth, ladies and gentlemen. We advocate growth for Mark Docherty, who's running in Regina Coronation Park, for hundreds like him who are afflicted with MS. He went to Bulgaria for a liberation treatment, and the report back is very encouraging. We know the reports are mixed. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, we pursue growth so that the government would have capacity to be the only place in Canada that says it is time for clinical trials. It is time in this place of the highest incidence of MS for us to lead, for us to invest a little bit with the Research Council, and for us to find some answers for those people that are suffering from MS. That's why we pursue growth, so that we would have that capacity. We advocate growth for Cam Manashis Deb, who in 2008 came to a thriving Saskatchewan from Bangladesh with $20 in his pocket and the big dreams that Candace has. He worked two jobs. There was a labor shortage, there still is. And in 1 year, he owned his own restaurant. I understand he now owns two. It doesn't sound like false expectations to me. It gets better. Mr. Deb brought his wife to Waldheim from Bangladesh this summer, last summer, and about 100 of his neighbors in the small town where they lived threw them a wedding reception and picked up the cost. That's Saskatchewan. And that's why we pursue a growth. You know, with a welcomed frequency, I'm coming face to face with the reasons why we would want a growing economy to fund these things, and it happened again last fall in Yorkton after a speech at the Chamber of Commerce there, and a gentleman came up to me and said, you know, I had a skiing accident last January, and my knee was pretty badly tore up. I saw the specialist here in September, this was October, I think, when the event, and the gentleman's telling me, I saw a specialist in September, saw him again, and he said, you need surgery on your knee. And the gentleman said, I asked when, and the specialist said, November. And so I was thinking, he's telling me this story now, he says, I was thinking, okay, November of 2011, that's a long time away, but that's sort of, and that's the wait list. And the doctor said, no, November, in 2 months. And the reason for that, ladies and gentlemen, is because growth has allowed our health minister to invest additional resources. Here lately, another $40 million. And our own innovation has allowed us to get beyond ideology and partner with some private clinics in the public system. And what should have been or could have been a 14-month wait for that man is now a 2-month wait. That's why we pursue growth in the province of Saskatchewan. He said to me, actually, I don't think I'm ready for the surgery that quickly. Finally, let me introduce you to Jason Kinoshita as the reason why we would pursue growth. You may have seen him in some of the ads we're running. He's from Toronto originally. He was coaching some volleyball at the U of R not long ago. He didn't have much intention to stay at the time, but someone found out he was a chemist, and before you know it, Mosaic was offering him a job, and then he moved here, and he bought a house in Langenberg, and then he got two of his buddies to move out here, and now they're Rider season ticket holders. He said he showed up at the first Rider game with a pumpkin. He didn't have that quite right. It's melons, not gourds, but the Rider Nation was very kind. They appreciated the innovation. He came back the next time with the appropriate uniform. And you know what? He and his friends, they make us better. All these new citizens, they make us more diverse. They make this a better place. And that's why we pursue growth. Ladies and gentlemen, growth may change economic forecasts, but mostly it changes lives. It makes our province immeasurably better. It is doing nothing less than building a brand new Saskatchewan that, as Walter Scott, our first premier, said, is a big land with big dreams, but that I would add is not so big that she would forget her most vulnerable. Let me conclude with the beginning of a proverb. It says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. For too long in our province, hope has been deferred. Prosperity was for some other place. Growth was for some other season. Promise was for some other time. And the heart of a province was sick, but not broken. For we knew, didn't we? We just knew that ours were not false expectations, but great expectations. And as we come into this time of choosing, let us send a message from this great hall in our largest city to the rest of the province and anyone else watching from around the world, a message that says this party, this room, these women and men are prepared to fight for the new Saskatchewan. A Saskatchewan where hope is deferred no more, where prosperity is for this place, where growth is for this season, where promise is for this time, our time. Today, my friends, the heart of your province is full and healed and strong and worth fighting for, and we will. May God bless the province.